ridiculous muscle.
Hallelujah. Good evening. This is the Christian Family and Choice Radio 92.9 FM. Your life, your salvation, your choice. Inviting to get something to write with and something to write on. Let us pray.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. On tonight, Father, we come exalting your name. We come glorifying you. We come magnifying you, Father. Father, we just thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, Lord God. Father, on tonight, I come to your throne once again, Lord God, just giving you praise, giving you honor, giving you glory. Father, on tonight, I come lifting all those that are out there on tonight, Lord God, that don't know about your Son, Jesus Christ. And Father, that someone would be put in their path, Father God, to minister onto those who are lost out there, Father, so they will come to repentance, Father God, and call on the name that's above all name, and that name is Jesus Christ, Lord God, that they will accept him in their hearts, Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord God. Anyone out there on the sound of my voice that's in radio land that has not received Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, and listening for the very first time, Lord God, let your spirit of conviction convict them, Father God, that they will fall on their knees tonight and call on the name of Jesus and accept him, Lord God, because you want no one to perish, Lord God. You want everyone, Father God, to know about your Son, Jesus Christ. So on tonight, Lord God, I just pray for those who are lost out there, Father God, asking you. I know you are so faithful that all your disciples who have accepted you, Father God, that they will go out into that dying world and tell people about that name, that name, that name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall tremble, Father God, and they will call on that name, Father God, and accept him in their heart, Lord God, and live holy in righteousness upon you, Father. So I just thank you for this tonight, Lord God. And Father, on tonight, we thank you for the man of God, Lord God. We thank you for his faithfulness, Lord God, that he come forth, Father God, to minister unto your people, to tell them about this man called Jesus, Lord God. We just asking you, Lord God, that you have your way, Lord God, and you have put 92.9 here, Lord God, for people to hear about your Son, Jesus Christ, Father. And Father, on tonight, that you would have your way, Father God, with your people, Lord God, all those who know you, that they would tell someone about Jesus Christ, Lord God. And Father, once again, take nothing for granted. We love you on tonight. We magnify you. We glorify you. We exalt you, oh God, as the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. You are the living water, oh God. You are the Rose of Sharon, Lord God. You are the lily of the valley, Lord God. There is none that's greater than you, Father. And I just thank you tonight. And I just glorify you tonight. And I magnify you in no other name but in Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Amen and amen.
Amen. Glory to God. God is still a good God. And the good thing about God being good, he's the same yesterday,
hallelujah,
today, and forever.
Thank
we
you,
thank
Jesus.
God for
yes,
the victory.
Lord.
The victory
thank
in
you.
Jesus is victory and honor. We thank you, Lord, for the Apostle Paul. And his writing,
thank you,
to his son in the faith, Timothy, say, from a child who was known the Holy Scripture, which was able to make thee wise.
Hallelujah.
Yet he told Timothy to study, to show yourself approved unto God,
you,
a workman that need not be ashamed,
yes,
rightly dividing the word of God. The early church,
thank
the Berean Christians, they searched the Scriptures out daily to see
yes,
if these
Lord,
things were so.
You.
Solomon, one of the wisest
Jesus,
men of his time,
Jesus,
he says, the glory of God to conceal a thing, but it's the honor of a king to search it out. So let's search it out and see what God is saying to us in his holy, written, precious words. Let's turn to the book of Kings, 1 Kings chapter 17, and see what God is saying to us there. 1 Kings chapter 17, get something to write with and something to write on and hear what God is saying to us. 1 Kings chapter 17, and see what God is saying to us there. God give us a book with 66 chapter, and he wants us to study. He says, study to show yourself approved unto God, a workman that need not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of God, so we could wrongly divide the word of God. So we're going to study and see what God is saying to us. 1 Kings chapter 17. Look at one verse. Look at the first verse. And Elijah the Tishbite, who was of the inhabitants of Gilead, said unto Ahab, as the Lord God of Israel liveth, before whom I stand, there shall not be dew nor rain these years according to my words. Now that's quite a statement there for one person to make. Now he's saying here that you're not going to have any rain. So here is a man who under the old covenant And the book of James, they say he's a man of like passion as we are. And here he is going to say, you're not going to have any rain for so many years. Well, who is this Elijah? Let's read that verse again. Who is this Elijah that he could make this statement? He's saying this to the king. Remember this king Ahab, him and Jezebel. I mean, they were quite a couple. And they had the whole city of Samaria worshiping Baal. I mean, throughout the city, they have these groves worshiping Baal and had 450 prophets of Baal, plus Jezebel have another 400. So, I mean, you talk about darkness is thick there, you can cut it with a knife. And here this prophet is saying to this king, this very wicked, evil king with his wife Jezebel, he's saying this to them. In look at that first verse. And Elijah the Tishbite, who was of the inhabitants of Gilead, said unto Ahab, as the Lord God of Israel liveth, before whom I stand, there shall not be dew nor rain these years, according to my words. These are strong words. Who is this Elijah? Well, this word here, Elijah, it's a compound word, Eli and Jah. And let's see where these words come from. Here, this guy come from wherever he came from and saying this to the king, you're not going to have no rain. So he has the power, God giving you power to move the clouds away from Israel, so they're going to have no rain in Israel for so many years, 3.5 years. Well, let's see something about this Elijah, how this has come about. Look at the book of Matthew. Matthew chapter 27. And let's see something about it, Elijah. Who is this Elijah? Matthew chapter 27. Jesus come towards the end of his earthly ministry when he's on the cross. And he made a statement. And we want to extract part of that statement, get something to write with and something to write on, and hear what God is saying to us. Jesus on the cross, his earthly ministry lasted approximately 3.5 years, and he's getting ready to leave the land of the living as he knew it. And he made a statement here while on the cross in Matthew chapter 27. Look at two verses. Look at 45 and 46, looking at Elijah. Look at those two verses. And from the sixth hour there was darkness over all the land unto the ninth hour. About the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice and said, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani? That is to say, my God, why dost thou forsake me? So that first part of Elijah, Eli, mean God. We're going to read those verses again. Elijah is a compound word, Eli and Jah. And we see here Jesus on the cross using this word. You look at the 46th verse, about the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice and said, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani? Which has been interpreted as, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? So Eli mean God or my God. And that's part of Elijah's name, Elijah. Can you see that? Look at something else. Look at the other part of his name. Look at Psalm 68. Elijah. Look at the 68th Psalm. David is given credit for writing most of the Psalm. The Holy Ghost speak through the mouth of David. And look at the 68th Psalm. Elijah, a compound word, Eli and Jah. The 68th Psalm. Holy men of God spake as the Spirit of God was upon them. Looking at Elijah. Who is this prophet that's saying to Ahab, the king, you're not going to have any rain? So God giving me power to stop the rain for 3.5 years over Israel. And he says, as the Lord liveth, you're going to have no rain. Elijah, compound word, Eli and Jah. Look at the 68th Psalm. Get something to write with and something to write on. Psalm number 68. And see what God is saying to us. Let's speak about verse 1. Psalm number 68. Let's speak it about verse 1. Let God arise, let his enemy be scattered. Let him also that hate him flee before him. As the smoke is driven away, so drive them away. As wax melted before fire, so let a wicked perish at the presence of God. But let the righteous be glad. Let him rejoice before God, yea, let him be exceedingly rejoice. Sing unto God, sing praises unto his name. Exalt him that rideth upon the heavens by his name Jah, and rejoice before him. So his name is Jah, so they get this Eli, Jah, Elijah. So look at that fourth verse again. Sing unto the Lord, sing praises unto his name, extol him, and write it upon the heavens by his name, Jah, and rejoice before him. So we see Eli, my God, and Jah. Well, let's see something else in the book of Exodus. Where this Elijah came from. Hallelujah. Exodus chapter 6. Elijah. Quite a power that he has, the power God give it to him. All power come from God. You're not going to have any reign before this mighty king, this very evil king. You ain't going to have no reign. Exodus chapter 6, Elijah. Hallelujah. Exodus chapter 6. Let's pick it up at verse 1. Exodus chapter 6. Get something to write with and something to write on. Then the Lord said unto Moses, now shalt thou see what I will do to Pharaoh, for with my strong hand I shall let them go, and with a strong hand I shall drive them out of his land. God speak unto Moses and said unto him, I am the Lord. I appear before Abraham and Isaac and Jacob by the name of God Almighty, but by my name Jehovah I was not known to them. So Jah is short for Jehovah. Can you see that? Jah is short for Jehovah. Look at that third verse again. I appear unto Abraham, unto Isaac, and unto Jacob by the name of God Almighty, but by my name Jehovah was I not known to them. So Jah is short for Jehovah. And we see this Elijah has this compound name Eli and Jah, which mean Jehovah is God. Can you see that? Jehovah is God. So two parts of it, Eli, my God, and Jah. Jah is short for Jehovah. Let's see what Jesus have to say about this Elijah. Matthew chapter 16. Let's see what Jesus have to say about this Elijah. Matthew chapter 16. Well, if Jesus going to use that word, may it have to be important. Every time I read things like this in my time of study, I say, God, you say if everything that Jesus Christ has done was put in the books, the world itself in all the books, and you leave a lot of things out to leave this in. So if he put this name inside there, he using this Elisha. And let's see what he's saying here. Matthew chapter 16. And let's pick it up at the 13th verse. Matthew chapter 16, looking at Elisha. Matthew chapter 16, let's pick it up at the 13th verse. And when Jesus came into the coast of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, whom do men say that the Son of Man am? Some of them say that thou art John the Baptist. Some say Elias. Others say Jeremiah, one of the prophets. He said unto them, but whom do you say that I am? Simon Peter answered, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus answered unto him, blessed are thou, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood has not revealed us unto, but my Father which is in heaven. And so on, he could build the church upon the rock. But who do men say that I am? So some men compare Jesus Christ with Elijah. Now in the Greek is not Elijah, but Elias. But it's the same Elijah. In the Hebrew, it's Elijah. In the Greek, is Elias. Look at this 13th verse again. When Jesus came in the course of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, whom do men say that the Son of Man am? Some of them said that thou art John the Baptist. Some say Elias or Elijah. So they compare Jesus with Elijah. So quite an honor for this Elijah, not for Jesus. Jesus is higher than all of us. So they compare Jesus. The people out in the world say you're like Jeremiah, you're like Elijah, you're like John the Baptist, or whatever. But notice they put them all up there with those men of God. Who do men say that I am? Some of them say thou art John the Baptist. Some say Elias. Others say Jeremiah, or one of the prophets. He said, never. Who do you say that I am? Simon Peter said, thou art the Son of God. And so on. So they compare Jesus, compare Elijah with Jesus. They compare Elijah with Jesus. And compare Jesus with Elijah. Compare Elijah with Jesus. Elijah in the Greek is Elias in the Greek. In the Hebrew is Elijah. Look at the next verse. Look at Matthew chapter 17. And see what he's saying to us. Matthew chapter 17. Elijah. Where this man came from? Who is he? That he could stop the rain for 3.5 years. Who is this? and he's under the old covenant, we under the new covenant. We have a better covenant established upon better promises. Matthew chapter 17, and look at verse 1. After 6 days, Jesus taketh Peter, James, and John, and his brother, bringing them up into a high mountain apart, and was transfigured before them, and his face did shine as the sun, and his raiment was as white as the light. And behold, there appeared unto them Moses and Elijah, talking with him. Then answered Peter and said unto him, Lord, it is good for us to be here. If thou wilt, let us make thee 3 tabernacles, one for thee, one for Moses, and one for Elias. And while they yet speak, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and behold, a voice came out of the cloud which said, This is my beloved Son, whom I am well pleased, hear ye him. And when the disciples heard it, they fell on their faces and were so afraid. Jesus came and touched them and said unto them, Arise, be not afraid. And when they lift up their eyes, they saw no man save Jesus only. And they came down from the mountain. Jesus charged them, saying, Tell the vision to no man till the Son of Man is risen from the dead. So here again, Jesus and the Mount of Transfiguration. Here is Elijah and Moses. We're going to read those verses again. Here is Elijah and Moses. Who do men say that I am? Jeremiah, John the Baptist, Elijah, or one of the prophets. So they compare Elijah with Jesus. Isn't that something? They compare Elijah with Jesus. Now they went on the Mount of Transfiguration, and here who look up the ruin to on the Mount of Transfiguration. Go back up to verse 1. After 6 days, Jesus taketh Peter, James, and John, his brother, and bringeth them into a high mountain apart, and was transfigured before them. His face did shine as the sun's raiment was white as light. And behold, there appeared unto them Moses and Elias talking with him. Moses and Elias. I wonder why Moses and Elias. Well, Moses represented the law, and Elijah represented the prophets. Very important. Look at these two. Behold, they appear unto them Moses and Elias talking with them. Then answered Peter and said unto him, Lord, it is good for us to be here. Let us make thee 3 tabernacles, one for thee, one for Moses, and one for Elias. So Moses and Elias represent that part of the Bible. Moses represent the law, and Elijah represent the prophets. Now let's see something here. Let's just take a little side excursion here. Look at the book of Luke. The book of Luke chapter 16. Remember the rich man and Lazarus? Look at something with that reading. The rich man and Lazarus. Look at something here. Went on the Mount of Transfiguration, run into Moses and Elijah. Who do men say that I am? So they compare Elijah with Jesus. Who is this Elijah? This compound word Eli and Jah. Eli, my God, and Jah, Jehovah. And the word put together is Jehovah is God. Notice the tense they use is God. Now look at this here with the rich man and Lazarus. He run into Elijah and Moses on the Mount of Transfiguration. I have a Red Lady edition. The head of the church is speaking and the apostle Luke is recording. Luke chapter 16, he run into Moses and Elias on the Mount of Transfiguration. Now look at this here. In Luke chapter 16, let's pick it up at the 19th verse. Let's pick up the story, and we want to get to a lower verse, but let's pick it up at verse 19. There was a certain rich man which was clothed in purple and fine linen, and fared sumptuously every day. And there was a certain beggar named Lazarus which was laid at the gate full of sores, designed to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. And it came to pass that the beggar died and was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom. The rich man also died and was buried. And in hell he lifted up his eyes, being in torment, seeing Abraham afar from Lazarus' bosom. He cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus that he dip his tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in his flame. Abraham said, Son, remember that thou in thy lifetime received good things, likewise Lazarus evil thing. Now he is comforted, thou art tormented. Beside all this, between us and you there is a great gulf fixed, so they which was passed from hence to you cannot, neither they could pass to us from thence. And he said, I pray thee therefore, Father Abraham, would that thou send him to my father's house, for I have 5 brethren, that he may testify unto them, lest they come into this place of torment. Look at verse 29. Abraham said unto him, they have Moses and the prophets. So if you want to get saved under the old covenant, well, not really saved, but if you want to get a promissory note on salvation, you have to go under the law and the prophet. So when Jesus was on the Mount of Transfiguration, he went into Moses and Elijah. Moses represents the law, the prophet. So here he said, I have 5 brethren. Let him go and testify them. He said, answer here, Abraham said unto him, they have Moses and the prophets. Let them hear them. And he said, name my father, Abraham. If one went on for them from there, they'll repent. He said unto them, if they hear not Moses and the prophet, neither will they be persuaded or one rise from the dead. So under the old covenant, you want to be saved, you had to go through the law and the prophet. Remember the rich young ruler come to Jesus and asked him, what must I do to have eternal life? He said, keep the law. Which one? He keep them all the commandments. Keep those and you'll go into Abraham's bosom. When Jesus died and he went into hell after he satisfied divine justice, he went into hell and preached the gospel to those down there, got them saved and delivered them unto glory. So he said they have Moses and the prophet. So Jesus and the Mount of Transfiguration run into Moses and Elijah. Can you see that? Amen, amen, and amen. Luke chapter 4. Luke chapter 4, Elijah. Luke chapter 4, get something to write with and something to write on. And Jesus again make a statement here, talking about this Elijah. Look at it, Luke chapter 4. And let's just extract part of the statement here. Look at this. Luke chapter 4, looking at Elijah. In the Hebrew, is Elijah. In the Greek, is Elias. Look at Luke 4, pick it up at verse 24. Verily I say unto you, no prophet is accepted in his own country. I tell you a truth, many widows was in Israel in the day of Elias, that's all Elijah, when the heaven was shut up 3 years and 6 months with great famine throughout all the land, but unto none of them was he sent save Elias, the widow of Zarephath, a city of Sidon. So only one, he'll send this Elias to this widow of Zarephath. Look at verse 25, unto none of them was Elias sent save a Zarephath, a city of Sidon, unto a woman that was a widow. So again, Jesus again mentioned the word Elijah here. He said it was famine throughout the land, but nobody, there wasn't sent to this widow only. Elias was sent to this widow, Zarephath, city of Sidon. So again, Jesus mentioned the word Elijah. So he getting a lot of play. Jesus mentioned that, look at verse 24 again. Verily I say unto you, no prophet is accepted in his own country. I tell you the truth, that many widows was in Israel in the day of Elias or Elijah, when the heaven was shut up 3 years and 6 months, when great famine throughout all the land, but unto none of them was Elijah or Elijah sent, save Sarepta, city of Sidon, unto a woman that was a widow. So again, we see the play here again, talking about that. Look at Luke chapter 9. Elijah. Elijah. Who is this Elijah? This compound word Eli and Jah. My God, and Jah, short for Jehovah. Jehovah is God. Elijah. I want to extract a verse here again. Look at the disciples mention the word Elijah. Luke chapter 9. So this guy's real Elijah. After all these years, he appeared on the Mount of Transfiguration with Moses, talking with Jesus. Luke chapter 9. And look at the 54th verse. Just extract that one verse. Look at the 54th verse. When the disciples James and John saw this, they said, Lord, will thou that we should command fire to come down from heaven and consume them, even as Elijah did? You see, under the oak, make fire come down from heaven and consume the messenger of the kings. And Jesus, he turned to them and he rebuked them and said unto them, you know not what man of spirit you are, for the Son of Man came not to destroy man, but to save them. And he went into another village and so on. But again, these two apostles talking about Elijah. Could we make fire come down from heaven and consume these people? Look at that 54th verse. And when the disciples, James and John, become apostles, they saw that, they said, Lord, will thou command that fire come down from heaven and consume them as Elijah did? He said, no, you don't know what manner of spirit will renew that. Look at the book of James, talking about Elijah. Who is this Elijah? This compound word, Eli and Jah. Jah is short for Jehovah. Jehovah is God. The book of James. Sometimes we read these things in the Bible and we can't believe what our eyes are seeing and what our ears are hearing. Elijah. Here Jesus and the Mount of Transfiguration running to Moses and Elijah represent the law and the prophet. The rich man and Elijah, yeah, they have Moses and the law. Let them go through the law of Moses and through the prophet if you want to go into Abraham's bosom. James chapter 5, James was also an apostle. God gives some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors, some teachers. What for? For the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we come into unity of the faith of our Lord and Savior. And here, he set them in the church first apostles, and the highest ministry gave apostles. So this is the apostle speaking. The old covenant came to us by the prophets, new covenant the apostles. Now look at James chapter 5 and look at this reading here under the new covenant. Look at verse 17. Elijah or Elijah's, tell you that Elijah is the Hebrew and Elias is the Greek. Elias was a man subject to like passion as we are, and he prayed earnestly that it might not rain, and it rained not on the earth by the space of 3 years and 6 months. And he prayed again, and heaven gave rain, and the earth brought forth fruit. We have to read those verses again. They say he's a man of like passion as we are. So he telling the king Ahab, listen, you're not going to have any rain for 3.5 years. You're not going to have any rain. So no clouds coming over Israel for 3.5 years. And look at this verse here. They say he's a man of like passion as we are. Look at it. Look at that verse. Elias was a man subject to like passion as we are. He prayed earnestly that it might not rain, and it rained not on the earth by the space of 3 years and 6 months. Now they say something here. I mean, now we talk about we're under a better covenant. Now look at what they say here. Now you would think that they had no rain over Israel. The country was divided in two parts. Israel is up to the north with the 10 tribe or 9.5 tribe with the capital Samaria, and down to the south is Judah with its capital Jerusalem. But that's not what they say here. That's not what they say here. Look what they say here. Elias was a man of subject like passion as we are. He prayed earnestly that it might not rain, and it rained not on the earth. You never see that before. First time you see the earth. Huh? The whole earth. Can you see that? The whole earth. Look at that. Elias was a man subject to like passion as we are, and he prayed earnestly that it might not rain, and it rained not on the earth by the space of 3 years. So all the earth. Throughout the earth. And he prayed again, and the heaven gave rain, and the earth. You never see that before. First time you've seen that. The whole earth. He came before them because of Ahab and Jezebel misbehaving. The whole earth. He didn't just say over Israel only. He said, can you read? My name doesn't appear there. Look at those two verses again before we move on. Look at those two verses again. Elias was a man subject like passion as we are. Well, he's under the old covenant. We're under the new covenant. We have a better covenant established upon better promises. He operated on 2 cylinders. We have 3 cylinders, spirit, soul, and body. 3 people under the old covenant had the Spirit of God upon them, the prophet, the king, and the priest. And the Spirit of God is upon them to stand in those offices. And he's a man like passion. He prayed over the whole earth. Can you read? By the space of 3 years and 6 months, Elijah. Can you see that? Amen, amen, and amen. Let's go back to 1 Kings chapter 17, looking at Elisha. 1 Kings chapter 17. Get something to write with and something to write on, and hear what God is saying to us in his holy, written, precious words. Now look at this reading here in Kings chapter 17. And look at verse 1. Again, and Elijah the Tishbite, who was of the inhabitants of Gilead, said unto Ahab, as the Lord God of Israel liveth, whom I stand before, there shall be no rain or dew these 3 years according to my words. So look at how he come in here. Look at it. And Elijah the Tishbite. And Elijah the Tishbite. Now look at something here with Melchizedek in Genesis. Genesis 14. Now keep your fingers there. Don't lose that spot. 1 Kings chapter 17. Look at verse 1 again. And Elijah the Tishbite. Now when you go to Genesis 14, look at the 18th verse. And Melchizedek, the king of Salem. You see, just come in right there. And Melchizedek and Elijah. Where these men came from? Where these men came from? Look at here, Genesis 14, look at verse 18. And Melchizedek, the king of Salem, brought forth bread and wine, and was the priest of the Most High God. And he blessed him and said, blessed be Abram of the Most High God, possessor of heaven and earth. And he blessed the Most High God, which had delivered an enemy to thy hand, and he gave him tithes of all. So just, and Melchizedek. Now look at here, go back to 1 Kings chapter 17, verse 1. And Elijah. And Elijah. Where does he come from? Look at something in the book of Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 7. Just like Melchizedek, so is Elisha. Look at this in Hebrews chapter 7. Hebrews chapter 7, get something to write with and something to write on, and see what God is saying to us in His holy, written, precious word. Hebrews chapter 7, and Melchizedek, and Elisha. Just come right in. Look at this here. Hebrews chapter 7, look at verse 1. For this Melchizedek, king of Salem, priest of the Most High God, met Abraham returning from the slaughter of the kings and blessed him, to whom Abraham gave 10 parts of all for being, by interpretation, king of righteousness, after that, king of Salem, which is king of peace. Look at the third verse. Look at the third verse. Put your finger on the third verse. Without father, without mother, without descent, having in beginning of days, no end of life, but is made like unto the Son of God, abided priest. So this Elijah is just like Melchizedek. He just come in. And Melchizedek, and so here they're saying this third verse, without father, have no earthly father, without father, without mother, without descent, with the beginning of days, no end of life, like the Son of God, abided the priest continually. So he just like Melchizedek and Elijah and Melchizedek, just come right in. Now watch something. Everybody else, you can see where they came from, and they give some where they came from. Now, let's go back to 1 Kings chapter 19. And let's see how we trace all these other prophets, but you can't trace Elisha. Watch this. 1 Kings chapter 19. We're just extracting part of the verses. 1 Kings chapter 19. And look at this. Now they're getting ready, Elisha. The Tishbite is getting ready to get off the scene. And look at God giving some instruction. Watch this. Now we're looking at all these prophets. We can't look at all of them. We look at few of them. The amount of 2 or 3 witnesses, let every word be established. So we're not going to look at all of them. But once you have 2 or 3 or even 4 or 5 or 6, it's established. Look at this here. Watch this. 1 Kings, you have no trace of Melchizedek. You have no trace of Elisha. And Elisha and Melchizedek. But look at this. Watch this. 1 Kings chapter 19. Let's pick it up at the 15th verse. Just let's extract something here. Watch this. 1 Kings chapter 19. Let's pick it up at the 15th verse. And the Lord said to him, go and return unto the way of the wilderness of Damascus. And when thou was comest, anoint Hazael the king over Syria, and Jehu the son of Nimshi shall thou anoint to be king over Israel, and Elisha the son of Shaphat of Abel-Meholah shall thou anoint to be prophet. And I said, notice it says Elisha the son of Shaphat. You notice that? Anoint Elisha the son of Shaphat. So he has a father, he has some lineage. Not so with Elisha and Melchizedek. So he has some lineage, come from somewhere. Can you see that again? Go back up to 15. And the Lord said unto him, go now and return to thy way, the wilderness of Damascus. When thou comest, anoint Hazael to be king over Syria, and Jehu the son of Nimshi, the son of Nimshi, shall thou anoint to be king over Israel, and Elisha the son of Shaphat of Abel-Meholah thou shalt anoint to be prophet. And I said, so he has a father. Can you see that? Let's go some more in the mouth of 2 or 3 witnesses. Let every word be established. So we see that he's son of Shaphat. Go to Genesis chapter 11 and look at Abraham. Genesis chapter 11. Hallelujah. And look at Abraham. Watch this. Genesis chapter 11. We're looking at all the prophets. They have a lineage for all of them. But we don't have one for Elisha. This compound word, Eli and Jah. Jah is short for Jehovah. Eli, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Hallelujah. Look at Genesis 11. We're just looking at trace how they come from somewhere. We start in the beginning with Adam and Eve. Adam and Eve had Kiran, Cain and Abel. Cain and Abel had kids, and dong and dong and dong. So we said, so. We saw Adam had many sons and daughters. We saw where they start. We can trace them. But you have no trace for Elisha. Just like Melchizedek. Look at this. Look at Abraham. Watch this with Abraham. Genesis 11, look at verse 27. These are the generation of Terah. Terah begot Abram, Nahor, and Haran, and Haran begot Lot. Now when you go down towards the end of that same chapter, go down to verse 31, and Terah took Abraham, his son, and Lot, the son of Haran, and the son's son, and Sarah, his daughter-in-law, and son of Abraham, wife, and they went from thence, and they came into Ur of the Chaldees, and they go down into the land of Canaan, and came there unto Haran, and dwell there. And the days of Terah was 205 years, and Terah died in Haran. So we see where Abraham come, we see Abraham father. Now we could go further up if you want to look at Terah, where he come from, but we're looking at Abraham the father. Well, look at something here in Genesis 20. We're looking at the prophets only. We're looking at prophets only. I'm looking at everybody, just looking at the prophets. Genesis 20. They went into the land of the Philistine unto Gerar, and they took Abraham's wife. And God is saying to Abimelech something here. Just want to extract one verse to see that Abraham was a prophet. That's what I want to get you to see. We see that he had a father and so on. Look at Genesis 20. Look at verse 7. Now therefore restore the man his wife, for he is a prophet. He's talking about Abraham. And he shall pray for thee, and thou shalt live, and thou shalt restore her not. Thou shalt, and thou surely shalt die, and all that are with thine hand. So we're looking at Abraham as a prophet. That's what I want to get to see. But you see, he had a father. We see some lineage. Can you see that? We see that Elisha, the son of Shaphat, he has a father. He has some lineage. Not so with Elijah. Look at it. Look at verse 7. Now therefore restore the man his wife, for he is a prophet. Talking about Abraham, he's a prophet. Look at the next one. Let's look at some more. The book of Exodus. The book of Exodus, chapter 2. And let's look at Moses. Was Moses a prophet? All right. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Exodus chapter 2. Looking at Elijah. Has no beginning, has no end. No earthly parents. Just like Melchizedek. And Elijah and Melchizedek. What we see, Elisha, the son of Shaphat. We saw Abraham had a father. We saw all them have some lineage, have some pedigree. Not him. Watch this, Exodus chapter 2, verse 1. And they went out a man of the house of Levi, and he took a wife of the daughters of Levi, and the woman conceived and bare a son, and said, saw that he was a goodly child, and hid him 3 months, because Pharaoh gave the instruction that they kill all the male children. So they hid the child and so on. Pharaoh's daughter in the process of time take up Moses, and they raise him in Pharaoh's, and Moses' mother raised him as a maid, and when he was grown to bring him to Pharaoh's daughter. Go down to the 10th verse. Go down to the 10th verse. Good read, Lord. We go to the 10th verse. And the child grew, and she brought him on to Pharaoh's daughter, and he became her son, and called his name Moses, and she said, because I have dreamed out of water. So we see Moses' parents and his mother and father from the tribe of Levi and so on, and Pharaoh's daughter give him that name Moses. Well, let's go a little more and look a little more about this Moses. Look at Deuteronomy. And let's see this. We see where he come from. Look at Deuteronomy 34. Look at Moses. All these prophets, we can see some lineage to them. Watch this. Elisha. A compound word, Eli. And Jah, Eli, my God, Jah, short for Jehovah. Come from word put together, Jehovah is God. Hallelujah. Jesus went to the Mount of Transfiguration. He met with Elijah and Moses. There were many prophets in Israel in the days of the famine. Oh, none of them were sent to the widow of Sarepta, but Elijah, the prophet. Deuteronomy 34. We're looking at all these guys had some lineage that we want to get you to see. Not Elisha. Deuteronomy 34, look at verse 10. Deuteronomy 34, look at verse 10. Pick it up at verse 10. Look at verse 10. There arose not a prophet sent in Israel like unto Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face, in all the signs and wonder which the Lord sent him on to do in the land of Egypt to Pharaoh and to all his servants and all the land. And in all that mighty hands and all the great terror which Moses showed in the sight of all Israel. So he says, not a prophet like Moses, who God know face to face. So Moses was a prophet, but we see where he come from. We see his parents, where he came from. Look at something else, the book of Joshua. Joshua was also a prophet. All of them have some lid. You're not seeing this with Elijah at all. Joshua chapter 1, Moses is off the scene. Joshua take his place. And look at verse 1. Look at verse 1. After the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord, it came to pass that the Lord speak unto Joshua, the son of Nun, Moses' minister, saying, so Joshua, the son of Nun. So Nun is his father. Can you see that? Look at that verse again. Look at that verse. Moses is off the scene. God anoint Joshua to stand in his stead. And look at that. Now after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord, it came to pass that the Lord speak unto Joshua, the son of Nun, Moses' minister, saying. Can you see that? Now look at some of the big guys and many others. We're just looking at a few here and a few there. Look at Isaiah. Look at the book of Isaiah. Looking at a few here and a few there. Notice all them, but no lineage for Elijah. He went to the Mount of Transfiguration, Elijah and Moses. There's no prophet like Moses. But you see where he came from? Joshua, the son of Nun. Look at Isaiah. Get something to write with and something to write on. Hear what God is saying to us in his holy, written, precious word, Elisha. Isaiah chapter 1. And look at verse 1. Isaiah chapter 1. And look at verse 1. The visions of Isaiah, the son of whom? We don't have that for Elisha, the Tishbite. Elisha, the son of Shaphat. Or not Elijah. Look at this. The vision of Isaiah, the son of Amos, which he saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem in the days of Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, Hezekiah, the kings of Judah. Can you see that? Better read that verse again. The son of Amos, Isaiah, the vision of Isaiah, the son of Amos, which he saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem in the days of Uzziah and Jotham and Ahaz and Hezekiah, the kings of Judah. What about Jeremiah? Let's see what they're saying about Jeremiah. No such lineage for Elijah, the Tishbite. Hallelujah, he's from the land of Gilead. And the inhabitants of the land of Gilead. Well, where's Gilead? Gilead is east of the Jordan. Before the children of Israel went into the promised land on this side of the Jordan, Moses defeated the two kings on this side of the Jordan. And it's from that part there, that's where Gilead is located, on this side of the Jordan. And he defeated the two kings there, Og and Sihon, the king of the Amorite and the king of Bashan. He defeated those two kings, and he gave that land to Gad, Reuben, and half of Manasseh. So Gilead is on this side, the east side of the Jordan. So that's where he's from. He's from the inhabitants of Gilead. Didn't say he born there, he's from the inhabitants there. That's where he dwelt. On the east side there, this side of the Jordan, Moses defeated them. When they crossed the Jordan, then Joshua take over on the other side and defeat the other 9.5 tribes. But on this side, Moses defeated them, the king of Sihon and Og, the king of the Amorite and the king of Bashan. He defeated them on this side, and he take their land and he give it to Reuben and Gad and half the tribe of Manasseh. So Gilead is in that side there, so he's in the inhabitants of Gilead. Look at here, Jeremiah chapter 1. Wonderful information. Sihon, the king of the Amorite, and Og, the king of Bashan. Moses defeat them on this side. They take their land and they give it to Gad, Reuben, and half the tribe of Manasseh. So 2.5 tribe on this side, 9.5 tribe on that side. So Joshua defeat them over on the cross over the Jordan. Jeremiah chapter 1. Look at verse 1. No such thing for Elijah the Tishbite. Look at verse 1. The word of Jeremiah, the son of Helkiah, of the priests that were in Anatot, in the land of Benjamin. Can you see that? The son of who? Helkiah. The word of Jeremiah, the son of Helkiah, of the priests that was in Anatot, in the land of Benjamin. How do you like that? What about Ezekiel? Take your time and put all these there, but we don't have that for Elijah. Don't have that for the priests of the Most High God, Melchizedek. Look at the book of Ezekiel. Just looking at a few here and there. And see, get something to write with and something to write on you to comfort their home. And see what God is saying to us, Elijah. This compound word, Eli and Jah. This mighty prophet, I look the king in his face, you're not going to have no rain. When we look at the book of James, he's saying the whole earth, there's no rain or dew for 3.5 years. Amen. Well, God will have to work a miracle. In the beginning, before we had rain, God caused a mist to go over all the earth and water all the plants. He may have to do that, otherwise for 3.5 years, everything would die. Every plant life would cease to exist. 3.5 years. Ezekiel chapter 1. And see what God is saying to us there. Get something to write with and something to write on. See what God is saying to us in his holy, written, precious word. Elisha, the son of Shaphat. We saw Isaiah, the son of Amos. You say Jeremiah, Hilkiah, the son of Hilkiah. And all these guys, you see all this, Joshua, the son of Nun. So they see some lineage to these peace. They run somewhere. Ezekiel, chapter 1, pick it up at verse 1. And it came to pass in the 30th year, in the 4th month, in the 5th day of the month, I was among the captive by the river Chebar, that the heaven was open, and I saw visions of God. In the 5th day of the month, which was the 5th year of Jehoiakim, the captivity, the word of the Lord came on expressly unto Ezekiel the priest, the son of Buzi, in the land of the Chaldean by the river Chebar, and the hand of the Lord was upon me, the hand of the Lord was there upon him. We're going to read those verses again. You see, all of them have the comfort. You see a lineage for them, not Elisha. Not Elijah. We're going to read those verses again. The book of Ezekiel, chapter 1. Can't read about everybody. We can give you a few here and a few there and see what God is saying to us in his holy, written, precious word. God give us 66 books and he wants us to study. He says, study to show yourself approved unto God. A workman that need not be ashamed, rightly divide the word of God. So nobody going to drag you down into Jonestown Gallery and give you Kool-Aid to drink, or into Heaven Gate cult in California or in Waco, Texas. You know. You know what's right from wrong. You know, read your book and find out what God is saying to us. Look at it. The book of Ezekiel, chapter 1. Get something to write with and something to write on while I'm cooking, I'm eating. Ezekiel, chapter 1 and verse 1. Now it came to pass in the 30th year. Now it take all this time, and I mean they specify the year, the time, the month and all that. That's one of the gifts of the prophet ministry. Give you all that detail. Look at that. Look at all that information. It came to pass in the 30th year, in the 4th month, in the 5th day of the month, I was among the captive by the river Chebar, and the heavens were open, and I saw visions of God. And in the 5th day of the month, that was in the 5th year of the king Jehoiakim captivity, the word of the Lord came expressly unto Ezekiel the priest, the son of Buzi, in the land of the Chaldean by the river Chebar, and the hand of the Lord was there upon him. How do you like that? Amen, amen, and amen. Let's see a little more. Let's dig a little deeper. Look at the book of Hosea. Look at that. Take time to give you all that. In order, two or three witnesses. Not that. And Elijah and Melchizedek. No lineage. No posterity. Nothing coming after. No beginning, no end. The book of Hosea. My favorite book. My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Hosea. Well, Daniel, he was taken captive and taken to Babylonian captivity. His lineage will be found in the book of Nehemiah, in the book of Ezra, and Chronicles, First Chronicles, you'll find his lineage there. You know, but here it doesn't say that here, but of course they take him when he was a young man and take him into the land of Babylon. Of course, the children of Israel keep sinning and sinning and sinning. They go into Babylonian captivity for 70 years. After 70 years, Nehemiah and Ezra, they went back to rebuild the temple and the walls, and they have to go through, get a priest that have Urim and Thummim to specify who's going into the land. A lot of people going in, they couldn't find any lineage for them, any pedigree. They don't know where they came from. So everybody going back into Jerusalem had to be checked out. And you couldn't find it. They have to get a priest that have Urim and Thummim to decide who's going back into that land, because some people will get in there who don't belong to the priesthood or don't belong to certain tribes that are speaking with the same old devil, lying. And that Hosea, chapter 1, let's read a few verses and see what God is saying to us. Hosea, chapter 1, look at verse 1. The word of the Lord came unto Hosea, the son of Beeri, in the day of Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, Hezekiah, kings of Judah, in the days of Jeroboam, the son of Joash, the king of Israel. two sets of different king here. One is for Judah, that's down to the south. Most of the good kings come from there. And most of the bad kings is from Israel up north with the capital Samaria. Most, not all. I mean, every now and again you get a bad king from down south in Judah. But most of the good kings is in Judah. Most of the bad kings is up north in Israel. Look at those verses again. Hosea chapter 1, my favorite book. My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Look at that first verse again. Hosea chapter 1, the word of the Lord came unto Hosea the son of Beeri in the days of Uzziah and Jotham and Ahaz and Hezekiah, kings of Judah, and in the days of Jeroboam the son of Joash, kings of Israel, king of Israel. So on, can you see that? Let's see the next one. But notice all this, we surround Elijah, nothing like that. Nothing like that for Elisha. Hallelujah. Joel. Hallelujah. Joel chapter 1. Get something to write with and something to write on and hear what God is saying to us in his holy, written, precious words. Joel chapter 1. Look at verse 1. What does that say there? The word of the Lord that came to Joel the son of Petuel. So we see he had a father, some lineage, and on and on and on. You look the lineage, you see if you go to the book of Chronicles, you see where they're going on and on and on and so on. You see where they came from and where they're going and so on. But look at it, the word of the Lord came on to Joel, the son of Petuel. Hear you this, the old man, and so on. Give it that. We're just looking at that part of it. Can you see that? Amen, amen, and amen. Couldn't give you all, but we could give you a few. Some of them we have a set of tapes and file, some other way. Some of those guys, we couldn't tell anything about these guys. But we have a set of tapes and file some other way. Jonah, the whale man. And let's see what God is saying about him. Jonah, get something to write with and something to write on. Hear what God is saying to us. Notice that all these prophets, not Elijah, and Elijah, and Elijah, just show up, and Elijah. And so, look at Jonah chapter 1 and verse 1. Look at verse 1. The word of the Lord came unto Jonah, the son of Amittai, saying. So you see, he come from somewhere. Look at that verse again. Jonah chapter 1, verse 1. The word of the Lord came unto Jonah, the son of Amittai, saying, arise and go to Nineveh, that great city, and cry against it, for the wickedness is come before me. And Jonah flee from the Lord and so on. But Jonah, the son of Amittai. Can you see that? Let's look at a few more before we close. Hallelujah. Look at Zephaniah. Hallelujah. Zephaniah. No such thing for Elijah, the Tishbite, and him. And Melchizedek has no beginning, no end, no descent, no mother, no father. Just come, and Elijah, he just come. Zephaniah chapter 1, look at verse 1. Get something to write with and something to write on. Going to these books, some of you can still see you turning the pages. You didn't get there yet. Those pages never been there. They're stuck on the 23rd Psalm of the Lord's Prayer. Come on, move through the Bible. Let your fingers do the walking through the Bible. Come on. Study to show yourself approved unto God, a workman that need not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of God. Zephaniah chapter 1, and look at verse 1. Zephaniah chapter 1, look at verse 1. The word of the Lord which came unto Zephaniah, the son of Cushi, the son of Gedaliah, the son of Amilara, the son of Hezekiah, in the days of Josiah, the son of Ammon, king of Judah. Quite a bit of information in that one verse. Zephaniah, the son of Cushi. Oh, he's a Cushite. He's a Cushite. For your information, Cush means black. So Zephaniah, a Cushite. Look at that word again. And the word of the Lord came unto Zephaniah, the son of Cushi, the son of Gedaliah, the son of Amariah, the son of Hezekiah, in the days of Josiah, the son of Ammon, king of Judah, utterly consume all the things and so on. That part. Let's close with this one. Zechariah. Zechariah. Add these words to your vocabulary. Zechariah. Zephaniah, Hosea, Joel, Jonah, Ezekiel, Jeremiah, Isaiah, Joshua, Moses, Abraham, add these words, Elisha and Elisha. Zechariah chapter 1. Hallelujah. And look at verse 1. In the 8th month, in the 2nd year of Darius, or Darius, came the word of the Lord unto Zechariah, the son of Bechariah, the son of Iddo, the prophet, saying, I'm going to read that verse again. Can you read? Look at that verse again. Zechariah chapter 1, verse 1. And look at that. In the 8th month, you know, they specify, they give the time and the month and the day, and they give all that. I mean, yes, that's part of the prophet ministry. Give you all that details. In the 8th month, in the 2nd year of Darius, came the word of the Lord unto Zechariah, the son of Bechariah, the son of Iddo, the prophet, saying, I said the Lord, and so on. Hallelujah. Let's go back to 1 Kings. Elisha. 1 Kings chapter 17. Now we look in the book of James and it says he's a man of like passion as we are. And he prayed earnestly. So if he could pray earnestly and get it, then God is saying to us, because the third person of the Godhead cannot lie. The Father, the Word, and the Spirit are one. So if he says he's a man of like passion as we are, and he can do that, and Jesus in his writing in the Gospel according to John, he says, as he is, so are we. The works that he do, shall we do also on greater works than Shiloh? Well, if somebody's telling a lie or somebody's telling the truth, I go in with the truth. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, not a truth, the life. The works that I do, shall you do also on greater works than these shall you do. And here in the book of James, they say, Elijah is a man of like passion as we are. And he prayed earnestly that it might not rain for 3.5 years, and it did not rain. And he prayed again and it rained. So he's telling that you could pray and get some things done. You could pray and get something. Something else we're looking at in all those reading we did there. Notice all those are ministry gifts. All those are ministry gifts. Can you read? All those are ministry gifts. All those prophets that we give you to Abraham, the ministry give Moses, Joshua, all those Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, Hosea, Joel, Jonah, Zephaniah, Zechariah, Joshua, all those are ministry gifts. 1 Kings chapter 17 and verse 1. And see what he's saying there before we go to part 2. Well, look at that again, Elijah. And look at your just comment, and Elijah the Tishbite, which was of the inhabitants of Gilead, and we say Gilead is on the east of the Jordan, and on that side over there, inhabit, stay with the inhabitants there, and they occupied there was Gad and Reuben, and half of Manasseh. Look at it, Elijah the Tishbite, who was of the inhabitants of Gilead, said unto Ahab, to his face, as the Lord God of Israel liveth, before whom I stand, there shall not be dew nor rain these 3 years according to my words. Now we notice this time the country was divided in two parts. Now he's dealing with this bad set up at the north with Ahab and Jezebel. They up in the north, the 10 tribes to the north. He's saying this is fixed. They're not going to have no rain for 3.5 years. No rain in the land. Part 2. And let's see what God is saying. Look at the works of Elijah. He's a prophet. And God gives some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors, some teachers for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come in a unity of the faith. Look at this. Look at the works. We're looking at the works of Elisha, the prophet. He's a man of like passion as we are. And he said something that will come to pass. Now look at this. Look at it. 1 Kings chapter 17, and he said there'd be no rain. There's no rain. And look at look at chapter 18, and look at the works of Elijah the Tishbite. This compound work, Eli and Jah. And after 3.5 years, now he's going to pray and they're going to get rain. But look at this. The hand of the Lord is upon him. Watch this. Now, if the hand of the Lord is upon him and he's a ministry gift, what about those ministry gifts today? And we have a better covenant established upon better promises. Now, look at this reading here. Watch it. Look at this. Now, he prayed there'd be no rain, and he's going to pray when rain going to come for 3.5 years, no rain. Look at it. 1 Kings chapter 18, pick it up at verse 41. And Elisha said unto Ahab, get thee up and eat and drink, for there is sound of the abundance of rain. And Ahab went to the eat and drink, and Elisha went to the top of Carmel, and he cast himself down upon the earth and put his face between his knees. And he said unto his servant, go now and look towards the sea. And he went and he looked, and he said, there is nothing. And he said, go again 7 times. Went 1 time, 2 times, 3 times, 4 times, 7 times. And it came to pass at the 7 times, he said, behold, there ariseth a little cloud out of the sea like the man's hand. And he said, go and say unto Ahab, prepare you the chariots and get thee down, for the rain stop ye not. And it came to pass, and meanwhile, the heaven was black with clouds. You see, he prayed that no rain. Now he prayed that rain come back now. Prophet, now a ministry gift. And there was great rain. So Ahab rode and went to Jezreel. Look at verse 46. Look at when he had the Lord upon you, what you could do. Now Ahab is riding a chariot, I mean, and all those horses full speed ahead. Look at verse 46. The hand of the Lord was upon Elisha, and he girded up his loins and ran before Ahab to the entrance. So he ran faster than him. The Spirit of the Lord upon you, you could go faster than him. When the Spirit of God upon you, you could do mighty things. Can you see that? Now Ahab is riding, going to Jezreel, and he girded himself up, the hand of the Lord upon him. So if the hand of the Lord is upon you, you could do mighty things. The anointing, the great anointing is upon you, upon Ezekiel and upon many others, and so on. But look at that. Look at that. And it came to pass, verse 44, at the 7th time that he went, behold, there ariseth a little cloud. You see, all those are facets of revelation. You see, he planted a little seed, and that seed could come. Talk about a mustard seed could be the smallest seed, but when it planted, growth becomes so huge. You see, it's a little cloud. But that little cloud, that like the fist of a man hand coming, rain is coming. And that's the way you sow a little seed, and you can get a big crop. Prepare you the chariots and get thee down and run and stop thee not. And it came to pass that meanwhile the heavens was black with the clouds and the wind, and it was great. So you see, he stopped the wind from coming. He stopped the clouds from coming. Don't come over here for 3.5 years. And look at it, verse 46. And the hand of the Lord was upon Elijah, and he girded up his loins and ran before Ahab. To the hand of the Lord, you could do mighty things, and the hand of the Lord is upon you. Can you see that? Amen, amen, and amen. Now let's go back to 17 and see some of the works of Elijah. 1 Kings chapter 17, look at verse 2. And the word of the Lord came to him, arise and get thee hence and turn eastward and hide thyself by the brook Chariot that is before Jordan. And she with her daughter drink at the brook, and have commanded ravens to feed. Now look at this, God speaking to the birds. You know, the Bible says Christians going before the judgment seat of Christ. When you get before there, he going to say, look, I speak to the birds. And they listen, they was faithful. Look at that. Get thee hence and turn eastward and hide thyself by the brook Chariot that is before Jordan. It shall be that thou shalt drink of the brook, and I have commanded the ravens to feed thee. So he went according to the word of the Lord, and he went and dwelt by the brook Chariot that is before Jordan. Look at verse 6. And the ravens brought him bread and flesh in the morning and bread and flesh in the evening, and he drank of the brook. And it came to pass after a while that the brook was dried up because there had no rain in the land. But look at the faithfulness of birds, morning and evening. Some Christians, you couldn't get them to come to church for 3 straight weeks. Come 2 weeks, they miss 2 weeks, they come faithful. Look at the birds. He's going to bring up this before you. And this is under the old covenant. The birds. The birds. He speak to the birds and they listen. Now look at this one here. Let's take a little side excursion. Look at the book of Jonah. Look at the book of Jonah. Go to the book of Jonah. Get something to write and something to write on. Look at this. Look at the book of Jonah. Now keep your marker, we're going back there. He speak to the ravens, and morning and evening they feed Elisha. What about you? You're not even faithful in paying your tithes. Look at you. Look at this. Faithful, morning and evening. Birds. Look at Jonah, chapter 2. And look at the 10th verse. Look at the 10th verse. That's embarrassing for some Christian. That's embarrassing. That's very embarrassing. Look at the 10th verse. And the Lord speak unto the fish, and it vomited up Jonah upon dry land. So the fish, if the fish is that large, could hold Jonah, mean have to be whale size. And whale size fish live in deep waters. And he give the fish instruction to go and put him on dry land. The fish take him out from the deep seas and bring him on land, put him on land, a fish under the water. Birds feed him. Elisha, morning and evening. Look at this. Look at that 10th verse. I mean, you read these things, it's just embarrassing for some people. God tell him to study, they wouldn't study. Go to church, they wouldn't go. Yeah, be faithful to the things of God. Wouldn't do it. Speak to the fish, look at. And look at something else. Look at this, listen to this. He only said one time. How many times you hear the gospel? How many times you hear to be loving one to another? How many times you hear to study? Huh? How many times you hear that? Don't forsake the assemblies and brethren. Look at it. One time. The Lord speak unto the fish, and it vomited up Jonah upon dry lands. To the fish under the water. Never went to school, can't read and write. Ah, but the fish, listen. Go back to Genesis, go back to Kings 17. Now look at it. And read those verses again. Command them. And faithful. Morning and evening. What about you? The works that I do shall you do also, and greater works than these shall you do, because I go unto my Father. 1 Kings chapter 7 verse 2. And the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, get thee hence, and turn eastward, and hide thyself by the brook Chariot, that is before Jordan. And it came to pass that as they drink of the brook, that it will command the raven to feed thee there. And he went there according to the word of the Lord. Notice, God tend to do it, he did it. All these are facets of revelation. God, and God didn't tend to do it one time. You get to there and I'll feed you there. You go somewhere else, you're not going to be fed. And he went according to the word of the Lord, and he went and dwelt by the brook Chariot, that is before Jordan. Look at verse 6. And the ravens with an S, not just one, all of them obedient. All of them, ravens with an S, brought him bread and flesh in the morning and bread and flesh in the evening, and he drank of the brook. And it came to pass after a while that the brook dried up because there had no rain in the land. But morning and evening, and ravens, all of them, not one, many. Can you see that? You're obedient to the things of God. Hallelujah. He could do these things. Now look at something here. Look at something here with man. God going to use man to do this little side, something we need putting these things in, because you, God knows who's listening. Some of you might be listening in a while. Joshua chapter 10. And look at this. He speak. Elijah speak. Now remember, Elijah was a prophet. We look at also Joshua was a prophet. Is that true? Look at this. What is these are prophets? These are ministry gifts. He commanded ravens to feed morning and evening. Faithful. Tell the fish, go put them on the land. Fish didn't argue them. Just go put them on the land. Find land, wherever land is, go to land, put them on the land. Joshua chapter 10, and look at this. You know, I read these things and I say, God Almighty, these folks were under the old covenant. I mean, you just give them one set of instructions, they listen. Christians supposedly saved, full of something. Talk to them over and over and over. Can't get them to live right, can't get them to do right, can't get them to be consistent. One time you speak to the fish, take my land. Ravens, faithful, morning and evening, bring it. That's embarrassing for some people. Can't come to them, the word is no good. They said they're going to come, they don't come. Said they're going to do it, they don't do it. I mean, just, but here, one time, speak to the fish. One time, the raven, every morning and evening, feed him. Look at this. This is a little side something. You know, we're just going around here to come back. Joshua chapter 10, and look at verse 12. Then speak Joshua the Lord in the day that the Lord deliver up the Amorite before the children of Israel. And he said in the sight of Israel, son, stand still in Gibeon, and moon in the valley of Ajalon. And the sun stood still. Some of you never see that. The sun stood still. He speak to the sun. He speak to the sun. Look, he speak to the sun and it listen. He's a prophet, a ministry gift. Look at it. And the sun stood still and the moon stood still, and the people avenged themselves in the enemy. And it's not written in the book of the Joshua, so that the sun stood still in the midst of the heaven and hasted not to go down about the whole day. And there was no day like it before or after it. And the Lord hearkened unto the voice of a man. Voice of a man. For the Lord fought for Israel. We have to read those verses again. You have something to write with us, something to write on. Yeah. Speak to the raven, bring him morning and evening. Speak to the fish. Now he is Joshua, speaking to the sun and the moon. Are we going to read that again? God listened to man. What about you? You could go to God and say, wait a minute. He wasn't even saved. He under the old covenant. Look at those verses again. Go back to verse 12. Get something to write one. Don't be in a hurry to move to the next scripture. Just chew on it for a while and see what God is saying to us. When you go to stand before God, you want to talk to some of you in the office. Joshua chapter 10, look at verse 12. Then speak Joshua to the Lord in the day when the Lord delivered up the Amorites before the children of Israel. And he said in the sight of Israel, sun stand still in Gibeon and moon in the valley of Ajalon. He's speaking to the sun and the moon. Stand still. Look at verse 13. And the sun stood still and the moon stayed until the people avenged themselves upon their enemies. Is not it written in the book of Joshua? So that the sun stood still in the midst of the heaven and hasted not to go down a whole day. Look at verse 14. Put your finger on the 14th verse. Put your finger on the 14th verse. Look at it. And there was no day like it before or after that the Lord hearkened unto the voice of a man. The Lord fought for Israel. How you like that? Let's see another one before we go back there. Look at Isaiah. Look at 2 Kings. Keep your marker there. We're going back there. We didn't finish there. We're just looking at these little side excursion. 2 Kings chapter 20. Keep your marker on 1 Kings 17. We're going back there. You have more than one fingers. Let them do the walking through the pages of the Bible. Got somebody to write with something. Look at Elisha. Elisha. God sent a raven to feed him morning and evening. Mighty, he tell the rain, the sun, no more, no rain for 3.5 years, Elisha. Look at this. Look at 2 Kings chapter 20. And let's pick up the story at verse 1. We want to go into a lower verse, but let's pick it up at verse 1. 2 Kings chapter, looking at Elisha, but we've taken all these side excursions to come back and see that these men are ministry gift and God is no respecter of person. Hezekiah, 2 Kings chapter 20 verse 1. In those days was Hezekiah sick unto death, and the prophet Isaiah, the son of Amos, came unto him and said unto him, thus said the Lord, set thine horse in order, for thou shalt die and not live. And he turned his face to the wall and prayed unto the Lord, saying, I beseech thee, O Lord, remember how I have walked before thee in truth and with a perfect heart, and done that which is good in thy sight. And Hezekiah wept sore. And it came to pass, before Isaiah was gone into the middle court, that the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, turn again and tell Hezekiah, the captain of my people, thus said the Lord, God of thy father David, I have heard thy prayers, I have seen thy tears, and behold, I'll heal thee on the third day, and thou shalt go up unto the house of the Lord. I'll add unto thy days 15 years, and deliver thee and the city out of the hands of the Assyrian, and defend the city for my own sake and for my servant David's sake. And Isaiah said, take a lump of fig. And he took it and laid it on the boil, and he recovered. Look at verse 8. Hezekiah said unto Isaiah, what shall be the sign that the Lord will heal me? And he said, and look at it, and that I shall go up unto the house of the Lord on the third day. Isaiah said, the sign that thou shalt have of the Lord will do this thing that he has spoken. Shall the shadow go forward 10 degrees or go backward 10 degrees? Hezekiah answered and said, it's a light thing for the shadow to go down 10 degrees, nay, but let the shadows return backward 10 degrees. And look at verse 11. Look at verse 11. And Isaiah the prophet cried unto the Lord and brought the shadow 10 degrees backward. And is it not going down in the dial of Ahaz? So instead of going down 10 degrees, he let it go backwards. So if it come 4 o'clock, you can even go back to 8 o'clock in the morning. How will you like that? So they just speak. But look at verse 11. And Isaiah the prophet cry unto the Lord. Speak unto the Lord. Say, turn it back 10 degrees. Joshua says, sun stand still in Gibeon. Moon in the valley of Ajalon. Stand still. And it stands still. Didn't move. How will you see that? Go back to 1 Kings chapter 17. Looking at Elisha. A compound word, Eli and Jah. Jah is short for Jehovah. Elijah means Jehovah is God, or the God of Jehovah. Hallelujah. Go back there and see that. Hallelujah. And look at this. Now the raven feed him there and so on. Let's go to the 8th verse. Let's see the works of Elijah. 1 Kings chapter 17. Look at the 8th verse. And the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, Arise and get thee to Zarephath, which belongeth to Zidon, and dwell there. Behold, I have commanded the widow woman there to sustain thee. And he arose. Notice every time God speaks to him, he just listens and do it. God want to talk to other people. I mean, these folks are under the old covenant. The Spirit of God is upon them. Nobody was saved. There's 3 people have the Spirit of God upon them. The prophet, the king, and the priest under there. But whatever God him, just do it. And you wonder why they're successful. God, they just do it. Just do it. That's why he says sometimes he wants us to become like little children. Whatever you tell children to do, do it. Go to bed. Go to turn off the light. Turn off that TV. You know? You whatever them just do. Look at it. Look at this again. Sometimes this is the reason why it don't work, because you're not doing what he said, doing what you want to do. He said Israel went and set up their own righteousness, not the righteousness of God, but their own righteousness. Look at this here. And the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Arise and get thee to Zarephath, we belong to Zidon, and dwell there. Behold, I have commanded a widow woman there to sustain thee. And he arose and went to Zarephath. Go to Zarephath, go to Zarephath. Go to Zarephath. And when he was came to the gate of the city, behold, there was a widow woman there gathering sticks. And he called her and said, Fetch me, I pray thee, a little water in a vessel that I may drink. And as she was going to fetch it, he called to her and said, I pray thee, bring me a morsel of bread in the hand. And she said, As the Lord God liveth, who I have not a cake, but a handful of meal and in a barrel and a little cruse of oil. Behold, I am going to gather 2 sticks that I may dress it for me and my son, that we may eat and die. Elijah said unto her, Fear not, but go as thou hast said, but make me thereof a little cake first, underline the word first, and bring it unto me, and after that make for thee and for thy son. For thus said the Lord God of Israel, The barrel of meal shall not waste, neither shall the cruse of oil fail, till the Lord sendeth rain upon the earth. And she went and did according to the saying of Elijah, and she and he and her house did eat many days. And the barrel of meal wasted not, neither the cruse of oil fail, according to the word of the Lord which was spoke by Elisha. We have to read those verses again. Now quite a bit of information there. And now remember, this is the last. This is it. She said, This is all I have. I'm going to eat this for me and my son and die. Well, many times in our life, we have to make this decision in our life. We stand in this very strategic time in our life, in this very pivotal point. We could move to this side or that side, and we could make sometimes the wrong decision if we don't follow God. Because remember, He is the way, the truth, and the life. Not a truth, the truth. He is. Now, she could have do what she want to do. The sense is we walk by faith, not by sight. We look at things that are not seen, not things that are seen. Things that are seen are temporary, things that are not seen are eternal. And you could be looking in your hand at that last dollar or that last whatever it is, that last meal, and you die. You're looking at that because you're walking by the senses. But God is a spirit. And they that worship and worship in spirit, and when you're walking by the senses, Satan is God of the senses. You see, God is God of the Spirit. Now look at those verses again. We're going to read that again and see something here. Look at it. Watch this. And the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, Arise and get into Zarephath, that belong to Zidon, and dwell there, for I have commanded a widow woman there to sustain thee. So he arose and went to Zarephath, and he came to the gate of the city, and behold, there was a widow woman there gathering sticks, and he called her and said, Fetch me, I pray thee, a little water in a vessel that I may drink. And if she going to fetch it, he called to her and said, Bring me, I pray thee, a morsel of bread in thy hand. And she said, As the Lord God liveth, I have not a cake, but a handful of meal in a barrel and a little cruse of oil. Behold, I am gathering 2 sticks that I may go and dress it for me and my son, that we eat it and die. Now if you do that, you walk by the senses, you're going to die. But if you do what God says, you're going to live. Elijah said unto her, Fear not. Go thy way, do as thou hast said, but make me thereof a little cake first. You see, take care of the things of God first. Take care of the things of God first. Seek ye first, and everything else is going to be added to you. And because she was obedient, now there's another facet of revelation here. Elijah said unto her, Fear not, go thy way, do make me thereof a little cake first, and bring it, make it and bring it. Bring all the tithes in the store that be meet in my house, and prove me now, here what said the Lord of hosts, if I not open you the windows of heaven and pour you out, bless me, no room to receive it. Bring it. quite a lot of nerve. He come from wherever he come from. She making it, saying, I just make it, I'm coming to get it. You make it and bring it. You see, faith is an ark. Faith is an ark. Elijah said unto her, fear not, go do as thou hast said, but make me thereof a little cake first and bring it unto me. And after make for thee and thy son, make for me first, and after make for you and your son. He got a lot of nerves. For thus said the Lord God of Israel, the barrel of meal shall not waste, neither shall the cruse of oil fail until the day that the Lord sent rain upon the earth. And she went and did according to the saying of Elijah. And she and he and her house did eat many days. Look at verse 16. And the barrel of meal wasted not, neither the cruse of oil fail according to the word of the Lord which spoke by Elijah. Now you have workings of miracle, and this is a continuing miracle. This is a continuing miracle. You see, to turn water into wine, that's a miracle. But this is a continuing miracle every day, because remember what she had in her, that was the last meal. Every time she go to the barrel, there's a meal there, there's a little oil. Every time she go to the barrel, there's a little meal, there's some oil. Every day she go, now you're talking about 2.5 years, 3 years. 3 years. Remember, she had, this was the last meal in her hand. This is it. She said, I'm going to make this to me and my son, we're going to eat and die. But every day she go there, there's a meal there. Until God sent rain upon the earth. So you're talking about 3 years. Because the famine lasted for 3.5 years. So you're talking about 3 years. Every day you go, there's meal there. That's a continuing miracle. That's a continuing miracle. You see, to open the Red Sea is one thing. That's a miracle. But to keep those water, those walls of water up like that, that's a continuing miracle. You see, that's a continuing. 3 years. Every time you go there, there's meal. But she had eaten that meal with her and her son, they'd die. But he said, bring it for me, you make it first, and bring it for me first. Then make for yourself. And that continued for 3 years. Not 3 weeks, not 3 days, 3 years. Every time they go there, there's a meal. There's a meal. There's a meal. That's a continuing miracle. A miracle is an event in the natural world outside the established order, possible only by divine intervention. Look at this. First, go back to the book of Genesis. A continuing miracle. Genesis chapter 4. God is speaking to you, you're not listening. Taking care of your business, you have your hair done, your nails done, you do everything else, go to the laundromat, to the cleaners, everything. When you're finished, then you want to take care of God. It doesn't work like that. Doesn't work like that. I going to be first on the throne. Nobody else first. I'm first. Seek ye first. Look at Genesis chapter 4. And look at verse 1. Take care of God first. Hallelujah. First. Genesis chapter 4 and verse 1. And Adam knew Eve his wife, and she conceived and bare Cain and said, I've gotten a man from the Lord. And again she bare the brother Abel, and Abel was the keeper of the sheep, and Cain was a tiller of the ground. In the process of time, it came to pass that Cain bought of the fruit of the ground an offering unto the Lord. Abel also bought the first sling of the flock, the fat thereof, and the Lord had respect unto Abel and his offering. You see, he gave God the best and first. Give it to God. You see? And God loved that. Take care of me first. Huh? But unto Cain and his offering he had not respect, and Cain was very wroth, and his countenance fell. Look at verse 6. And the Lord said unto Cain, why art thou wroth? Why is thy counsel fallen? If dost thou well, shall not thou be accepted? If dost not well, sin light at thy door, and unto thee shall be thy desire, and thou shalt rule over him. You see? And the Almighty God come and tell him what to do. Just do what your brother do. Do as your brother do. Do what he's doing. He take the best and bring it to me. But look, go back up to the, look at it. Go back up to the third verse. In the process of time, that's whenever. That's somehow some people come to church. 3-4 weeks they don't come to church. When they come to church, they're just paying 1 week tithes. You're in trouble. You're in trouble with a big T. You can 3-4 weeks you don't come to church. When you do come, you're just paying 1 week. All those weeks you didn't come, you have to pay for those weeks. That's rent you pay for labor on planet Earth. You're back up in your rent. If you don't pay your tithes when you're supposed to pay it, there's a penalty of 20% have to be added to it. So if you're supposed to pay $100 every week and you don't pay that week, when you're going to pay it next week, you have to add $20 to it. One-fifth have to be added to it. And every week, every time you miss, one-fifth. If you don't do that, you'll never catch up, and you'll always find yourself, you're paying, but you just can't get out of the hole and can't. No, it doesn't work like that. Doesn't work like that. You pay the utility company, render to Caesar what Caesar, give God what his own. All right? You don't pay on time, it's a penalty of 20%. One-fifth have to be added to it. That's the B-I-B-L-E. But look at it, what he said here. And it came to pass, look at it. Look at verse 3. And in the process of time, whenever, once a month, once every other month, you come to church and you're just paying for that time. Look at it. It came to pass, and Cain brought the fruit of the ground and offering unto the Lord whenever he come to church. 2-3 weeks he missed whenever he come late and leave early. Look at verse 4. Abel also bought of the firstling of the flock the fat thereof, and the Lord had respect unto Abel and his offering, but unto Cain and his offering he had not respect, and Cain was very wroth, not just wroth, very wroth, and his countenance fell. And the Lord said to him, why are thou wroth? Why is thy countenance fallen? If dost thou well, shall not thou be accepted? Just do what he do. Come every week, pay your tithes. If you not be there, but send it in. Pay your tithes. Be up to date. If does not well, shall not thou be accepted? Does not well. Sin like that I do. And of course, things are working. When things are working, this is what happens when things are not working for you. You're doing everything to make money. Also, the unscrupulous thing you're doing to make money because things are not working for you. Look at it. Look at verse 7. If does thou well, shall not thou be accepted? This is not well. Sin like that I do, and unto thee shall be thy desire, and thou shalt rule of it. Cain talked with Abel his brother, and it came to pass when they were in the field that Cain rose up and killed. And look at it, Cain rose up against Abel his brother and slew him. And the Lord said unto Cain, Where is Abel thy brother? And he said, I know not. Lying. Not only a murderer, but a liar. He break 2 divine laws there. Thou shalt not kill, he break a divine law. Thou shalt not bear false witness. So that's 2 divine law he broke. All because he wouldn't pay his tithes. He break a divine law. Now thou art cursed from the earth, which opened his mouth to receive thy brother blood from thy hand. When thou tillest the ground, it shall not henceforth yield unto thee her strength. A fugitive or vagabond shall be in the earth. You see? Because you're not paying time, you're cursed. Nothing works for you. Always find yourself climbing a hill financially and health-wise. First, because you didn't see God first. Look at the book of Exodus. Look at the book of Exodus. First, make the meal for me first and bring it to me. You know, you say Israel want to go and set up their own rights. You want to do what you want to do. No, you do it the way God said it. I am the way. He been here first. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Exodus chapter 23. All these little snapshots we're taking. And look at this. Exodus 23. Is Exodus in the Bible?
Yes, it is.
Just want to make sure we're in the B-I-B. L-E. Look at this. Just extracting one little verse here. Look at this verse. You know, just piece as we go through this. Look at it. Look at this in Exodus 23. Look at the 19th verse. The first of the first fruit of the land thou shalt bring unto the house of the Lord thy God. Thou shalt not see the kid in its mother's milk, but not that part we're looking at. The first of the first fruit. The first of the first fruit. Take the first of the first. In other words, he take the fattest thereof, the best thereof. So the first of the fruit of the land shall thou bring unto the house of the Lord thy God. The first of the first. Back then you were dealing primarily with agrarian societies who would bring their stuff. Today we deal with checks, and cash, and monies converted into money. In the book of Deuteronomy says if it's too long, you have to convert it into money. And bring it in. But look at it. The first of the first fruit of the land thou shalt bring unto the house of the Lord thy God. In other words, make sure God is there. Can you see that? Look at the book of Nehemiah. First. Want to leave God for third, fourth, fifth, sixth. Doesn't work like that. Nehemiah. Just looking at little snapshots here. And Nehemiah chapter 10. I remember Nehemiah have to go and rebuild the walls. Everything fall apart. Everybody was violating the Sabbath and doing all sorts of things. So we're just looking at peace. Put it back together. If you want things to work for you, Nehemiah. Chapter 10. Bring the first of the first for me. Elijah went to the widow's house. He said, you know, you make it for me first and bring it to me first. Then make for you and your son. Make it for me first. And because she was obedient throughout the famine, 3 years, every single day you go, there's food there. Take them throughout the famine. A continuing miracle. Nehemiah chapter 10. Look at verses 35 and 36. Look at those 2 verses. 35 and 36. and to bring the first fruit of our ground and the first fruit of all the fruits of the trees year by year unto the house of the Lord, unto the house of the Lord, unto the house of the Lord. Also the firstborn of our sons and of our cattle that is written in the law, and the firstling of our herds and our flocks to bring to the house of our God, unto the priests that minister in the house of our God. First. Let's read those two verses again. Get something to write with and something to write on. See what God is saying to us in His holy, written, precious word. First, now He went to rebuild. Everything was fall apart and destroyed the temple, and He went back to rebuild it. Put everything back in order. Get back where you used to be. Look at it, 35. And to bring the first fruits of our ground and the first fruits of all the fruits of the trees year by year unto the house of the Lord, unto the house of the Lord. Verse 36, also of the firstborn of our sons and of our cattle that is written in the law, and the firstling of our herds and our flocks to bring unto the house of our God, unto the priests that minister in the house of our God. Not them God with a small g, God with big G. Can you see that? Book of Proverbs. The book of Proverbs. First, tell the widow one, you bring it to me first. I ain't coming to pick it up. You bring it. Do the way God said to do it. He met Zacchaeus. He said, make haste. Zacchaeus, make haste. Come down, Zacchaeus. Make haste. Make haste. The lug crawl around and come whenever you good, well, ready. No, he said, make haste. Make haste. Go to Zarephath. Go to Zarephath. Take the first. Proverbs chapter 3. Look at two verses. Look at verses 9 and 10. Proverbs chapter 2, look at verses 9 and 10. Honor the Lord with thy substance, with the last fruits of thine increase. When you done pay all your bills, do your nails, have your hair done, go to the cleaners, the landmark, go to the movie, buy of you, and when you have finished, do everything, then take care of the Lord. Is that what he said? Honor the Lord thy God with thy substance, with the first fruit of all thine increase, so shall thy barn be full of plenty, and thy press shall burst out with new wine. Solomon was very, very, very rich. Richest man of his time. How did he get? Let me just go to that. Let me see that day quickly. Let's go to 1 Kings. 1 Kings chapter 10. Look at Solomon. Look how he get there. 1 Kings chapter 10. Get something to write with and something to write on. 1 Kings chapter 10. 1 Kings chapter 10. And look at verses 14 and 15. Now the weight of gold that came to Solomon was 600 threescore and 6,000 of gold, beside all that have the merchant men of the traffic of spices and merchant, all the kings of Arabia and the governors of the county. Look at verse 23, go down to the 23rd verse. So King Solomon exceed all the kings of the earth for riches and for wisdom. Go back to Proverbs. He wrote the book of Proverbs. Well, the Spirit of God, of course. He's the richest. Well, how he get there? Look how he get there. Just what Elisha said to the widow, you bring it to me first, then make for you and your son. And throughout the year, throughout the famine, they never run out of food. A continuing miracle. Look at here. Proverbs chapter 3. And look at verses 9 and 10. Honor the Lord with thy substance, with the first fruit of all thine increase. Not some of your increase, all thine increase. Look at verse 10. So shall thy barns, with an S, B-A-R-I-N-S. Barns, B-A-R-N-S, barns, plural, be filled with plenty, and thy press shall burst out with new wine. Barns, in other words, all your banking account, full of plenty. Honor the Lord thy God with thy substance and first fruit of all thine, so shall thy barns be full of plenty, and thy press shall burst out with new wine. Go back to 1 Kings chapter 17. First. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Amen. Amen and amen. Glory to God. The works of Elijah. Elion Jah, my God, the God of Jehovah, for Jehovah is God. Hallelujah. Let's go on to the 17th verse. The works of Elisha. 1 Kings chapter 17, let's pick it up at the 17th verse. And it came to pass afterwards these things that the son of the woman of the prophet of the house fell sick, and the sickness was sore, and there was no breath left in him. And she said unto Elisha, what have I to do with thee, O man of God? Art thou come to call my sins to remembrance, and to slay my son? And he said unto her, give me thy son. And he took him out of her bosom, and carried him up into the loft where he abode, and laid him upon his own bed. And he cried unto the Lord, and said, O Lord God, thou hast brought evil upon the widow. You notice death is evil? I notice death is evil. Death is an enemy of God and of man. And he cried unto the Lord and said, O Lord my God, thou hast brought evil upon the widow of whom I have sojourned by slaying her son. And he stretched himself upon the child 3 times. And he cried unto the Lord and said, O Lord my God, I pray thee, let the child's soul come again into him. And the Lord heard the voice of Elijah, and the soul of the child came into him again, and he revived. And Elijah took the child and brought him down out of the chamber into the house, and delivered him unto his mother. And Elijah said, see thy son liveth. And the woman said unto Elijah, now by this I know that thou art a man of God, and the words of the Lord as in thy mouth is truth. We have to read those verses again. Now notice, he's the first one in the Bible to record and raise the dead. That's quite a feat. Elijah, the first one to raise the dead, bring somebody back to life. Well, of course, the Spirit of God working through him. But we're saying that. Got it? And it came to pass after this thing that the son of the prophet, the mistress of the house, fell sick, and the sickness was sore, and there was no breath left in him. And he said unto Elijah, what have I done to thee, O man of God? And thou come to call my sins to remembrance and slay my son? And he said unto him, give me thy son. And he took him out of her bosom and carried him up into the loft where he abode, and laid him upon his own bed. And he cried unto the Lord. I wonder why would God answer him? You know, there's benefits for taking care of God people. There are benefits. Now look at something here. Look at something. In Matthew chapter 10. First one recorded to raise the dead. Elijah. Matthew chapter 10. And look at this. Matthew chapter 10, under the old covenant is the prophet, under the new covenant the apostles. Now look at this. Matthew chapter 10, let's pick it up at verse 1. And when he had called him for his 12 disciples, he gave them power against unclean spirit to cast them out, to heal all manner of sickness and all manner of disease. Now the name of the 12 apostles are these. First Simon, who's called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, Philip, and Bartholomew, Thomas, and Matthew the publican, James the son of Alphaeus, Levius, who was surnamed Thaddeus, Simon the Canaanite, Judas Iscariot, who also betrayed him. These 12 Jesus commanded them, saying, go not in the way of the Gentiles, or any city of the Samaritan, enter you not. But go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel, as you go pray, preach, that the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Look at verse 8. Heal the sick, cleanse the leper, raise the dead. So to raise the dead, you have to have power, because back up there, he said, he give them power. So to raise the dead, you have to have power. You see that? So he's the first one recorded in the Bible to raise the dead. But notice, God have to give you the power. God give him power. Look at it. To heal the sick, you give them power to heal the sick. So you have to have power to heal the sick. But what is power? What kind of power is he talking about? Look at it. Cleanse the leper. Yeah. Cleanse the leper. Raise the dead. Cast out devils. Freely have received, freely give. So all these things to do here, these 4 things, do you need power? To heal the sick, you need power. To cleanse the leper, you need power. To raise the dead, you need power. To cast out devils, you need power. Let's go back up to the top again. The first one recorded to raise the dead is Elijah. Look at verse 10. Go back up to verse 1. When he called unto his 12 disciples, he gave them power against unclean spirit to cast them out, to heal all manner of sickness and all manner of diseases. Now the name of the 12 apostles are these. First is Simon, who's called, he tell you who he give the power to. That's what we're looking at. Everybody don't have it. That's what I want to get to say. Who he call it become apostle. Those are the ones who give the power. Everybody don't got it. The name of the 12 apostles are these: first Simon, who's called Peter, and Andrew his brother, James the son of Zebedee, and John his brother, Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew the publican, James the son of Alphaeus, Levius who was surnamed Thaddeus. These have the power. Simon the Canaanite, Judas Iscariot, who also betrayed him. These 12 he sent forth, commanded them, said, go not in the way of the Gentiles, nor any city of the Samaritan enter you not. Go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. As you go, preach to the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Heal the sick, they have to have power. Cleanse the leper, have to have power. Raise the dead, you have to have power. Cast out devils, you have to have power. Freely receive, freely give. Now look at this. Acts chapter 10. First person recorded to raise the dead is Elisha, the Tishbite. Acts chapter 10. Hallelujah. Acts chapter 10. Get something to write with and something to write on and hear what God is saying to us in his holy, written, precious word. Acts chapter 10. Look at the 38th verse. Put your finger on the 38th verse. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. Look at that verse again. Notice God anointed him with power. You have to have power. Well, did Jesus raise the dead?
Yes.
He raised Jairus' daughter back to life. He raised the widow of Nain's son back to life. He raised Lazarus back to life. So you have to have power. So look at that 38th verse. How God anointed Jesus with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed, for God was with him. Give him power. Now look at what he's talking about here. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 12. You got to have power. Who gave you the power? God. Notice he gives some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists. Everybody don't got it. Look at this. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, looking at Elisha. First person required to raise the dead. Quite a feat. Somebody dying. Pray they bring them back. Then Elisha, the son of Shaphat, in the old covenant, and so on. We're not dealing with him, we're dealing with Elisha. Eli and Jah. Jah is short for Jehovah. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Let's pick it up at verse 1. Get something to write with and something to write on. 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 1. Now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I would not have you ignorant. You know that you were Gentiles carried on to these dumb idols, even as you were led. Wherefore I give you to understand that no man speaking by the Spirit of God call it Jesus accursed, and that no man can say that Jesus is Lord by the Holy Ghost. Nor that diversities of gifts but the same Spirit, their difference of administration but the same Lord, their diversity of operation but the same God which worketh all in all. But a manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit with all. For to one is given by the Spirit a word of wisdom, to another the word of knowledge by the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing by the same Spirit, to another workings of miracle, to another prophecy, to another discerning of spirits, to another diverse kind of tongue, to another the interpretation of tongue. Look at verse 11. But all these work in one of the self-same Spirit, dividing to every man severally as he will. So they have these nine gifts of the Spirit, and three of them is called the power gifts. Three of them reveal something, which is the gifts of revelation, word of knowledge, word of wisdom, and discerning of spirit. They are the revelation gifts. Then you have the gifts of utterance, prophecy, tongues, and interpretation of tongues. Those are the gifts of utterance. And then you have the power gifts. So he anointed them with power, so he gave them power. So that gift to raise the dead, you need those three power gifts to raise the dead. You need gifts of healing, workings of miracle, and special faith. Whatever that person died from, whatever sickness, AIDS, and whatever brain tumor, whatever they died from, they have to deal with that right away. So you need gifts of healing. Then you need workings of miracle to bring that spirit back. That spirit gone, if the person under the old covenant died, they got into Abraham's bosom. You have to bring that spirit back. If the new covenant, they go on to heaven, rather bring that spirit back. You need workings of miracle. Then that person needs special faith. Special faith, receive a miracle. So you need all those gifts working again. You need the power gifts. So you give them power to do these things. So here you have Elijah with operating with those three gifts under the old covenant, because his son was sick and his sickness was sore and he died from that sickness, whatever he had. He died from that. And he prayed and he cried to God, and God answered his prayer and bring it back. But there's another facet of it to see something here. Sometimes because you do things for the kingdom of God, God reward you because of your work that you did for the kingdom of God. Now remember that Elijah went to her house and she sustained him for 3 years. She took care of him. She listened to the word of God. She could have moved by the senses and eat the cake and the oil and that would be the last supper. But she listened to the man of God and said, make it and bring it to me first and we're going to live. And she was obedient to the word of God. And because we're obedient to the word of God, God bless us for being obedient to his word. And she take care of the man of God. And there's a reward for taking care of the people of God. There's a reward for taking care of the people of God. So he take care of her. Then they look at Elisha, the son of Shaphat, the same thing. Yeah, he's passing by the woman, the Shunammite. Every time he passes, he's going to Mount Carmel, he passes. This woman, she saw him, she said, this man is a man of God. So she said, what I'll do, I'll build him a prophet chamber. So she built a prophet chamber for him. So whenever he and Gehazi pass in, they come in and they will stay there and they will refresh herself and she'll get them meals to eat and a place for them to sleep. So you see, she take care of the man of God. And he prophesied, he said, listen, you're going to have a son. I really don't want a son, but you're going to have a son. So she had a son. And the process of time when the son was grown, he died. And you see, because she take care of the man of God, he cried out to God and remind God that she was faithful. I didn't ask her for anything. I was just passing by and she said, the man of God, anytime he passed, she prepared him, give him something to eat, something to drink to refresh himself. So she said, this is the man of God. And she take her own money and build a prophet chamber for him. So now that she's in trouble, her son died, he cried out to God and God bring the child back. Well, it's the same thing with Elijah the Tishbite. He take care for 3 years, he stayed there living at her house. And there's a reward for taking care of the man of God. Let's read that in the book. Let's look at Matthew chapter 10. See, there's a reward for taking a God people. A God people. Now, a lot of say they're God people. But I say God people. Not people who say they're God people. God people. Look at this. I have a Red Lady edition. The head of the church is speaking. And Matthew is recording. There's a reward for taking care of God people because the widow woman, the widow of Zarephath, she take care of 3 years, feed him. Now she's in trouble. Crowd. God will answer that. Elisha, the son of Shaphat, every time he passed by, she take care of him, build him a prophet chamber. Her son died. See, she get that. She couldn't get pregnant, but they're barren. Well, she had a child. See, God will reward you because they're God people, not those people who say they're God people. God people. Matthew chapter 10, look at verse 40. Pick it up in the 40th verse. He that receiveth you, receiveth me. And he that receiveth me, receiveth him that sent me. Look at verse 41. He that receive a prophet in the name of a prophet shall receive a prophet reward. And he receive a righteous man in the name of a righteous man shall receive a righteous man reward. You see? There's a prophet reward. Because she take care of him, there's a reward. There's a reward. Look at verse 42. Whosoever shall give a drink of water unto one of these, a cup of cold water, and in name of the disciple, verily I say unto you, he shall no wise lose his reward. There's a reward for taking care. There's a reward. God people. I didn't say people. God people. People disguised, said the God people did not take the people down to join some guy and give them Kool-Aid to drink. Never get up. Look at that. Look at verse 40. There's a reward. There is a reward. I say there's a reward. Look at this 40th verse. Matthew chapter 10, verse 40. He that receive you, receive me. And he that receiveth me, receiveth him that sent me. This is a package deal. Receive the Son, you have to have the Father. Receive the Father, you have the Son. The package is like the wet and the water. Verse 41. He that receive a prophet in the name of a prophet shall receive a prophet reward. See, they get a reward taking care of the man of God. She was obedient. She could have made that decision and say, I don't know this man. He's just a stranger. Come to town. Tell me to give him the last meal. I have some kind of nerve. Tell me to make it and bring it to him first. Then I take care of myself. He got a lot of nerve. But she listened. And she did what the man of God say. And throughout the 3 years plus, the meal never run out. A continuing miracle. There's a reward for taking care of God people. I've seen that in my time. There's a reward for taking care of God people. Let's go back there before we close in 1 Kings chapter 18. Elijah, a compound word, Eli and Jah. In the Hebrew, it's Elijah. In the Greek, it's Elias. Hallelujah. Chapter 18. Look at the works of this man. Luke chapter 8. 1 Kings chapter 18. Sorry, Luke. Luke chapter 8. 1 Kings chapter 18. 1 Kings chapter 18. Hallelujah. 1 Kings chapter 18. And let's pick it up at the 19th verse. Look at the working of this man under the old covenant, used mightily of God. Look at what he said here. And look at this. All this is telling us something. All this is telling us something. All this is telling us something. All this is saying something to us. All this is saying something. Now look at in all this darkness, and look at Elijah in the midst of all that. Now remember, this guy was not saved. You saved. And look at he's standing there. You know, all these little things, you could put in all these little side excursion and say this. You know, here you have Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego against all that opposition. And they stand tall, they look Nebuchadnezzar's face, say, you could do what you good well please, we're not going to bow to no image. Here you have Elisha, you have all these prophets, and then you see God put all these things, God showing all these little pictures. He stand tall in the middle of that, he say, I'm the only one for God. Here you have Joseph in Potiphar's house. I mean, he had all the right, he could be mischievous if he wanted to, but he put his both feet down and said, I'm not going to do this. You see, and God going to bring all this before you. Here you have Jacob going to work for his father-in-law Laban. He waited 7 years for his wife, Rachel. When they gave him Leah, he had to work another 7 years. He keep his eyes on Leah, on Rachel, the woman that he wanted. He worked another 7 years. But he stayed there. So look at this here, this man here, Elijah. 1 Kings chapter 18. And look at verse 19. Now therefore send me and gather me all Israel onto Mount Carmel. And the prophets of Baal 450, and the prophets of the grove 400, which eat at Jezebel's table. Now all that darkness, and he's in the middle of all that darkness. Greater is he who's in me than he who's in the world. And he's standing in the middle of all that. You think about it. Jesus, when he went into his own hometown, they say he there could do no mighty work, but it's too much darkness there. You see, too much. He there didn't say he couldn't do it. Now look at Elijah standing in the midst of all these prophets worshiping Baal. Verse 20, so Ahab sent on to children of Israel and gathered all the prophets together unto Mount Carmel. And Elijah came unto the people and said unto them, how long shall you halt between two opinions? If the Lord be God, follow him, but if Baal, then follow him. And all the people answered not a word. Look at verse 22. I said, look at the 26. Look at that verse. Look at verse 22. I said, look at verse 22. Then said Elijah unto the people, I only remain a prophet of the Lord, but Baal prophets are 450. He in the middle of all that. What about you? What in your workplace or where you are, in your house where you live? Are everybody smoking, everybody drinking, everybody cursing, everybody being unfaithful to husband, everybody, you know, what about you? He in the middle of all that, he said, I'm the only one here for God. And he stand tall in Nuremberg. He's under the old covenant, not saved, operating in two cylinders, soul and body, Spirit of God upon him. Have the old covenant people under there were servants. We are sons. What about you? What about you, Elisha? To be continued, Elijah.
Yes, and I mean, you know, the whole thing is that, you know, God is showing us that, you know, these people wasn't even saved, and how they stood for him, no matter what, you know, and they was not afraid to talk about God back then. But look at us who are born again. Do we talk about him? You know what I'm saying? We got a better product than anybody out here. And we don't talk enough about him. You understand? And so, you know, I think somebody said this last night in Bible study. Is that this word of God is like, you know, people believe everything else, but they don't believe what God tells them. You understand? If he tell us he'll supply our needs, if he tell us he'll heal us from all sickness and diseases, we don't act like that. And then yet and still, and he tell us this, go out into all the world and preach the gospel. Are we doing that? Are we telling people about Jesus Christ? Do people on our job know about Jesus Christ through us? Are we telling them? Are we sitting next to a person? You ride the train, you sit next to this same person every day. Have you told them about Jesus? Have you invited them to church? Have you asked them, are they saved? Or are you sitting there reading your newspaper, not reading your Bible, because you're afraid of the gospel? This is really something else, because when you look at this, or do people know you? Are you just a part of them? Are you separated? You understand? When you walk in a room, do the conversation stop? Or do you get involved in the conversation? Ask yourself this, because let me tell you something. Jesus Christ is coming back, and he's coming back real soon. And I'm here to let you know, hell is real. It is not to be played with. Once again, I'm telling you, make sure your heart is right. Do what is right. We can take care of everything else, but not the kingdom, so the word of God continue to go forth. We always got to complain about the body of Christ, but what are you doing? You're complaining about it, but what are you doing? Amen.
Hallelujah. I want to give those that are listening an opportunity to receive Jesus as Lord and Savior. The Bible says, not my wish that any should perish. Doesn't want anybody going to hell. Hell was not made for you, but for the devil and his angel. You don't have to go to hell. All you have to do is to say yes. Not to fill out any form, quit your job, leave your husband and wife, abandon your kids, give up your apartment, change your name, bring some money, fill out the form. You don't have to do any such thing. Just say yes. Be part of the Say Yes Club. And you leave the kingdom of darkness and move to the kingdom of light. The apostle Paul and the Damascus said, who are thou, Lord? I'm Jesus. What will allow me to go into the city? I'll tell thee what thou oughtest to do. And he went in there. When Ananias came to him, he called him Brother Saul. So you can do the same thing, Brother Saul. You could be Brother Saul by repeating this. If you're already saved, stand proxy for somebody who's not saved. If you're not saved, then stand for yourself. Repeat these words of me from the bottom of your heart. Heavenly Father.
Heavenly Father.
You said in your holy word.
You said in your holy word.
Whosoever come to me.
Who should ever come to me.
I'll in no way cast out.
I will no way cast them out.
But I'll take them in.
But I'll take them in.
So I come to you.
So I come to you.
You didn't cast me
you
out.
You didn't cast me out.
But you took me in.
But you took me in.
And I thank you.
And I thank you.
Romans 10.
Romans 10.
Verse 13.
Verse 13.
Whosoever call upon the name of the Lord.
Who should ever call upon the name of the Lord.
Shall be saved.
Shall be saved.
So I call upon your
so
name.
So I call upon your name.
So I'm now
so
saved.
So I am now saved.
Romans 10.
Romans 10.
Verses 9 and 10.
Verses 9 and 10.
With the mouth confession is made unto salvation.
With the mouth confession is made unto salvation.
But with the heart man believe it unto righteousness.
But with the heart man believe it unto righteousness.
So I confess with my mouth.
So I confess with my mouth.
The Lord Jesus.
The Lord Jesus.
That he died.
That he died.
Went to hell.
Went to hell.
Spent 3 days.
He spent 3 days.
And three nights. Just for me.
Just for me.
Because I confess that with my mouth.
Because I confess that with my mouth.
And I believe that in my
and
heart.
And I believe it in my heart.
I'm now saved.
I'm now saved.
I now become
the righteousness
of God in Christ.
In Christ.
2 Corinthians
5:21.
Jesus. You represent me in heaven.
You represent me in heaven.
And I will represent you on earth.
Represent you on earth.
Jesus. I thank you.
I thank you.
For what you did for me.
For what you did for me.
On Calvary. Shedding your blood.
You shedded your blood.
To redeem me.
From the curse of the law.
Spiritual death. Poverty.
And sickness.
Satan. You're no longer my Lord.
You are no longer my Lord.
Jesus Christ.
Is my Lord.
And my Savior.
And he's my Savior.
I will live for him.
I will serve him.
I'll study his words. I'll be a good example.
For all to see.
And I thank you.
And I thank you.
In your name I pray.
In your name I pray.
Amen.
Amen and amen.
Amen. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Christianity is not passive but active. The Bible says when an unclean spirit has gone out of a man, he walketh through dry places seeking rest and find none. He's coming back. Come back and find the house empty, sweep and garnish. He going to get 7 more spirit, more wicked himself. Come back to dwell in the last of his words and first. Get busy. Start reading your Bible. Start with the gospel according to John.
Yes.
Read the first chapter. Read in the morning. Read again at lunchtime and bedtime.
Thank you.
Tomorrow you read chapter 2. Don't try to read everything in one time. Ask God to lead you to a church that will feed you spiritually.
Yes.
Don't go to a church because your friends are going there because there's a church down the block or across the street from where that may be so. But it may not be so. Ask God to lead you. When he leads you there, submit that authority. Be a blessing to them. God going to bless you. Amen. Father, we thank you for this time that you've given us.
Hallelujah.
The opportunities and privileges.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you for your son, Jesus
yes.
Christ. Triumphant, victorious Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord, for everything that you've done, what you're doing, and what you're going to do. We give you all praise, honor, and glory for all these things, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.
And amen.
And amen. Good night.
You have been listening to Pastor Randolph Ferdinand. Teachings from the Word. To get a copy of this teaching or any of the other series, call 347-533-4271. 347-533-4271. 4271. Like us on Facebook or YouTube at H2C3 Ministry. H2C3 Ministry. Go for the word.
That land, and he began.